So we talk about, or you talk about, democracy, economic and political, since you've been working a lot. Well, the book before your last book on Mind and Matter was on political philosophy, and in your preceding books on social science and sociology, you've also talked about your conception of democracy and of a democratic economy. So it would be nice if you could lay out a few of your planks of your conception, and perhaps how it differs from from others.
Okay, well, there have been a debate, as you know, over the past 2.5 centuries concerning democracy and its reach. And everyone agrees that democracy has been expanding ever since the French Revolution. But it's only in political democracy that has been expanding within countries across the world. The question is this: political democracy assumes that we are all equal. But in fact, we are not equal because we have different economic powers and cultural powers. And so it happens that even in the earliest democratic regime, in France and in the United States, political democracy is accompanied with a great disparity in economic power, so that ultimately the people who have with more economic power can also buy political power. Corruption is widespread. It's not limited to Italy. It occurs everywhere, wherever political parties representing the interests of the money, the properties, the classes can buy far more TD hours than the leftist political parties. Things are more complicated than that, because the extreme left, the Marxists didn't never cared very much for political democracy, particularly since the famous criticism of Marx of the Gotha program of the German Democratic, Social Democratic Party in the 1880s, something like that. Marxists usually called political democracy formal democracy, and they couldn't care less for that. I think that's a very bad, a very serious mistake, because if you enjoy political democracy, then you can fight for economic democracy and cultural democracy, and also biological democracy, equality of race, and so on. So, my proposal is this, that it's not a question of forgetting about political democracy, but of enlarging it to encompass not only economic but also cultural and biological democracy. But it's basic equality, or at least equality of opportunities for people of all ethnic groups and all occupations. More than that, traditional socialists, Marxists, have rejected the idea that workers can manage by themselves their workplaces. In other words, they have rejected cooperatives as being a distraction in the march, in the inevitable march towards economic society. Moreover, and of course, on the right wing, they say, well, cooperatives are not viable, they cannot compete with the big enterprises. But there are very interesting and all exceptions. For instance, there are thousands of very thriving cooperatives in Italy that are more than 100 years old and that have been able to compete with the private sector. Why? Because the private sector doesn't find it profitable to do certain kinds of work. But a good example is the desiccation of the swamps around Rome. No private firm would do that. So a number of unemployed workers in the Adriatic went to Rome and formed a cooperative, and they started working at that in the 1880s. Well, 30 years later, 40 years later, Mussolini continued to work, and he attributed the fascist regime all the virtue of having clean, desiccated those swamps. But actually, the people who started them and who worked there for several decades were members of a cooperative that was established precisely to do that kind of work, and they did it very successfully, even though they didn't have full support of the Italian state. To indicate, there is a number of cooperatives in Switzerland. For instance, the two main supermarket chains are cooperatives. They are doing very well. They are spread throughout the country, but they are distribution or trade cooperatives. They are not local cooperatives. There are work cooperatives in the States. For instance, wood of a certain kind is worked by these cooperatives. And but to me, the most shining example of a cooperative is the Mondragon conglomerate in the Basque Country. It has a very interesting history. It was organized by a Jesuit priest, José María Arismendiarreta, 53 years ago, during the Franco regime. And he allied himself with four engineers, and they set up a number of factories. But there are now more than 100 different firms, cooperative firms, that formed is a sort of conglomerate, very successful. They constitute the ninth firm in Spain. They produce not only for the internal market, but also for export. And they cover practically all the sectors of the economy. They've had only one thing, one bankruptcy in more than half a century. Whereas on the other hand, as you know, there is a yearbook of bankruptcies in the United States that shows that on the average, firms last only in the West, they last only about 5 years on the average. This cooperative firm has lasted for 10 times as much, for more than half a century. And one of the reasons is, of course, that if a firm, if an ordinary firm is a difficult problem, the workers couldn't care less. So they don't pitch in, they don't cooperate to solve the problem. In the case of a cooperative, since it is their own, they make sacrifices. And also, the various cooperatives, the flourishing cooperatives, the wealthy cooperatives, help the poorer ones. In any case, to me, the cooperative is the only solution, the only kind of economic democracy that works. It's completely different from were state-managed firms in the former Soviet Union that were a disaster, technologically backward. They were very often corrupt, they were administratively corrupt. In any case, they were quite inefficient. But that doesn't mean that necessarily all state-owned enterprises are inefficient. You can see the railways in Germany or in Switzerland or in France are very efficient, well managed, and not particularly corrupt. But in any case, still, the workers had really to say it was a state-owned cooperative, unlike a work cooperative, which is owned and managed by the workers. This one result, I think, in that it doesn't depend on banks. It has its own bank, its own financing, so that they cannot be ruined by banks, as it so often happens in the private sector. And it has its own university that trains administrators and qualified workers. So, Mondragon and the Italian cooperatives, and then of course the German and Swiss and French cooperatives, and also the Argentinian cooperatives that have been quite successful, show that it is possible, it is practical, it is profitable to organize production and trade in that form. So in any case, the ideal society in my view is one that gives the maximum freedom and at the same time responsibility. If you manage, well, you have participation, active participation in the management of your own firms or schools or whatever, you are going to be responsible. Otherwise, you leave the responsibility to the bosses. So this democratization of responsibility is technically and economically efficient. Now, participation is interesting. If you maximize participation, you also have a lot of waste of time. If everyone participates in the management of everyone else, it's chaos and a waste of time, long discussions and long meetings happen. This happened, I understand, in Cuba, the so-called local defense or whatever organizations. Every block has its own organization, and they spend nights and nights discussing details, and no one takes responsibility. The responsibility is so diluted that it takes just a waste of time. But in short, I think that from a practical point of view and also from a moral point of view, this expanded or integral democracy is what works best. So I call it integral democracy as opposed to the partial democracies, the purely political or purely racial or biological democracy and so on and so forth.
How would the limits to participation be gauged or imposed? Necessary?
Well, I think that people should be free to choose to participate more or less. There are some people who like participating and others who like to take more. It's very rare the case where people fight over workloads. People fight over power, but not over workloads. So it happens very, very naturally, I think. Competence is valued because people realize that efficiency requires technical competence. And so I don't think that you can legislate that in a way that, let's say, Fourier legislated or wanted to legislate a theory the way that his philosophers should work.
And the reward in a system like that, if it's neither primarily monetary reward nor primarily power, increased power, what would the reward be for someone to, say, take on the additional workload, take on the additional participation for the good of the whole?
Well, the main reward is economic security. Well, economic security is something that the capitalism didn't come in guarantee. Workers in the capitalist enterprise expect that any crisis, there will be congealed, it will be sacked. In a cooperative, this is not possible because they are owners, they don't sack themselves. So there is also the psychological reward that you see something that is shining, that you have contributed to it, it's yours. You're not working for someone else, you're working for yourself and your colleagues. Since this, of course, there are managers and so on, but the system is not organized hierarchically in the sense that authority can be challenged. Can be challenged in the assembly, and if an overseer or a manager is found to be tyrannical or incompetent, he can be removed. And I support that the stress caused by oppression, by arbitrary authority, doesn't exist at all. Exists in a much smaller way in cooperatives. So that there are not only monetary rewards, psychological rewards, which explains why people don't leave cooperatives. Once they are accepted, they stay there, they tend to stay. Mm-hmm.
The award that is perhaps referred to as psychological is recognition also from peers, which, exactly, which as we know is a big factor in science, motivation and reward. The other interesting thing about the cooperatives is that one doesn't have to speculate about them only in theoretical terms, whether it's an alternative form, but there's a long history of cooperatives. There are, of course, also some failures. I'm thinking of the kibbutz in Israel, which have, I think, by and large, disappeared as cooperatives and have all been turned into capitalist enterprises.
Well, the reason that they appeared is that they started, as they were flourishing, they started hiring Arabs to work, and of course, Arabs have not been welcomed on the same footing as Jews. They were discriminated against. And I visited several kibbutzes in Israel some 30 years ago. I didn't see a single Jew. They were all Arabs working there. The Jews were in Tel Aviv managing the business. They were really businesses like any others. But these are more important examples of failing cooperatives. The British cooperatives. After all, the British were the first to organize cooperative firms. The famous Rochdale movement. Rochdale is a small town near Manchester. And late 1840s or early 1850s, they organized a big cooperative movement, but only the felt or the branches of the cooperative movement were either trade cooperatives or banking cooperatives for lending for building societies. And they didn't have any work cooperatives. Like in Italy or in Spain, or in Argentina, where there are in the schools, corporate schools, private corporate. And so, another reason for the failure of corporates, not particularly to the Argentinian corporates, is that very often the managers were faithful but incompetent members of the Labour Party or the Socialist Party. They were entrusted, managerial jobs were entrusted to faithful members of the party. And a faithful socialist is not necessarily a competent man. So this applies particularly to the oldest Argentinian cooperative that was founded more about 110 years ago. We used to live in my famous age in a huge apartment building, very modern, very convenient, very well built, owned by these workers, El Honrado Obrero, the workers' household. Lately, a number of work cooperatives have been established and they are doing it quite well. Moreover, they obtained a legal victory. The legal status was finally recognized as a special law about cooperatives. But in any case, yes, cooperatives are possible, but provided they finance themselves and provided they don't limit themselves to trade, but they include all kinds of economic activity. Mm-hmm. And provided there is no political interference. Apparently, in Yugoslavia, the cooperatives were quite effective until politicians started to meddle with them.
Mm-hmm. Well, one sort of political interference would be useful, and that is if the state set favorable conditions for setting up cooperatives and for running.
Yeah,
that may
take the initiative, which is, I was hoping that Cuba would eventually learn to do that, but apparently they haven't done that.
I think they may be trying with their agricultural.
Yeah. I'm told that there are some attempts, but it took something like 40 years to understand that there is an alternative to the year. They thought that there were only two ways to organize the economy, either by the state or by the private sector. Well, they just serve one, the cooperatives.
Maybe this would be a good point at which to reflect on the actual world economic system and its power structures and its roaming dominance in really all respects, financial, economic, political, and cultural. And I guess to pose the question how this could, how one could imagine that this could be broken up in any way, or that this might be weakened or be replaced, at least partially, in the absence of any catastrophe.
How to go from the present capitalist organization to a really socialist one. Not the communist, not the Marxist one, but the really socialist one. Well, experience has shown that very often, at least in Italy, as it has often been the case, that cooperatives have been organized from failed capitalist enterprises. There was an interesting case also in Argentina some 10 or 15 years ago. Capitalist enterprises that were broke and they were taken over by the workers. In Argentina, the capitalists closed down the buildings and so on, and they cut them. They sold all the machinery, and so what the unemployed workers did was, so very often, they broke the locks, got into the buildings, and used whatever machinery there was left, and they associate themselves with other groups, and they've been thriving. They got profit, but the former owners didn't see any profit because it was not enough for them, but it was enough for the workers. Mm-hmm. So from the ashes of capitalism, real socialism may arise. Oh, this is a possibility that have been actualized in many examples in Italy and in Argentina. And quite unexpectedly, it was a spontaneous movement in both cases, that people who were left, all of a sudden, they were left unemployed. Well, what can we do? Well, let's keep doing what we did before, but instead of relying or expecting that the boss will call us, let's do it ourselves. Let's organize ourselves. And it worked in many cases. It was very interesting because the pressure was such in Argentina that the local legislatures in the city of Buenos Aires, in the province of Buenos Aires, had to recognize that, had to recognize the confiscation, the expropriation of the owners, because the owners didn't fulfill any social role. They kept owning empty factories that didn't provide any jobs. And so the legislatures admitted that, just as in the case of Amsterdam, the case of the squatters. Mm-hmm. It was a case of thousands of squatters who occupied buildings for a number of years. They were not reclaimed by their owners, and so they were recognized as the legitimate owners after a number of years. But there is, in Argentina, they say, a law, a very old law, is essential, that a property that is not occupied for 30 years belongs to, passes legally to the occupants, mm-hmm. to the squatters. Mm-hmm.